Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD, general physician. All my video lectures are mainly for educative purpose. They will be very useful to the students of fourth year, even second and third year, mainly for fourth year. And they will be very useful in your oral exams as well as good number of things will be useful in your theory also. Today we are starting with cardiovascular system examination, that is inspection of cardiovascular system. Almost 70 to 80% of the part is already done in respiratory system. But suppose in oral exam, if it is asked, examine the cardiovascular system, you cannot answer. It has to be done with respiratory system. I'll do only this much. No, you cannot answer that. You have to mention everything. And whatever we have done in respiratory system, we may not repeat some of those things. But you have to mention in a list. And when it is asked in an oral exam, you are supposed to answer all those things. And you are supposed to fill in the blanks. So, in inspection, we observe, we look at, and we are not allowed to use palm, that is to touch, and we are not supposed to use stethoscope, that is auscultation. So when you use a palm for what you are feeling, that is palpation, and when you percuss and listen to the sound, that is called percussion, and when you use a stethoscope, that is auscultation. So those are all the four different components of a cardiovascular system examination. So in inspection, what we do, yes, like what you do in elementary, what you do in a respiratory, all those things are to be observed. Standard principle, room should be fully illuminated, quiet room, person should be comfortable, by and large always examine in a supine posture, the chest part, that is entire thorax, should be uncovered. You stand on the right side. First, stand erect and examine the chest. Compare right with left, look at the precordium. And what you are looking at will be dealing in further slides. And second, you can look closer by bending little forward. And third way is, you have to sit down and look tangentially over the chest wall. That will help to identify the pulsation as well as some swelling if it is present. So, examination of cardiovascular system should be done in all these three positions. Standing position, little bending forward and tangentially. While looking at the cardiovascular system, we don't require to stand at the foot end. But if you want to compare the pulsation and you want to clarify the pulsation much better, then you might stand at the foot end and look at the pulsation, different pulsation. So as standard, when you are looking at the anterior chest wall, always by and large try to examine in a supine posture. It is the best position. If person is uncomfortable in supine position, then only try to examine in a sitting posture. When you are examining the posterior chest wall, then only you ask the person to sit. All clothes from the chest wall should be removed. At least up to umbilicus. Stand at the feet end of the patient. And in that standing at the feet of the patient, we want to look at the shape of the chest. And compare right with left, what we have done in a respiratory system. So we are looking at the symmetry and shape of the chest. You also look at the breathing movements. Any accessory muscle of respiratory muscles are working. Any accessory muscle like sternocleidomastoid. Look at the retraction of the lower intercostal space. All these things. That is rate, accessory muscle of respiration, nasal flares, retraction, suggest respiratory distress. By standing on the right side of the patient, look tangentially, looks in an erect posture as well as bending little forward, and try to identify the apical impulse and pulsation in other area like aortic, pulmonary, parasternal region, epigastric region, suprasternal notch, and also you can look on the posterior wall for Sussman's sign, that is intercostal pulsation. And also when you are looking at the anterior chest wall, you look at the skin for swelling, scar, any skin eruption, dilated veins, pulsation other than apical impulse, any pigmentation, etc. And also, ideally, we should be mentioning here, when you are mentioning the apical impulse, that is trachea, position of trachea, and in relation to the position of trachea, we'll be mentioning regarding the apical impulse. We'll be repeating again, because that is the very, very important part and very frequently asked in your oral. So, position is very important. The room should be fully illuminated, and uncovering of the part, that is also very important. So, adequate light and fully exposed part of the chest. Then only you will be able to identify some of the things which are clearly seen on the chest wall, like injury marks, scar, pigmentation, etc. And also regarding the shape of the chest. And you have to observe from above downwards, front part of the chest, back part of the chest, and even the lateral part of the chest. You have to examine all these things. While examining the back part of the chest, person has to be in supine posture. In sitting posture. But while examining the anterior part of the chest wall, and you may look even the lateral chest wall in a supine posture. But while examining the posterior chest wall, by and large, the person should be in a sitting posture. So, when you are examining the posterior chest wall, sitting posture, and you are looking at the cervical, thoracic, and upper lumbar spine for any deformities, so you look for the spine deformity, you look at the vertebras, any deformity, any swelling, and costovertebral tenderness is only by palpation. It is not on inspection. And any scar which can be there on the posterior side. So try to look for those things. And any deformities of ribs. Any swelling other than spine. You look in the posterior wall. And you ask the person to bend forward and touch the toe without bending at knee. And in this position, you look tangentially in the intercostal space for pulsation. In normal person, there are no pulsation in intercostal space. But in case of coarctation of aorta, because of dilated arteries, intercostal arteries, there will be visible intercostal pulsation. And this is called Sussman's sign, which is very characteristic of coarctation of aorta. So now I'm just going through that, some of the things which will be already discussed in respiratory system, I'll be mentioning at this stage, and the things which we discuss in detail will be mentioning separately. But in oral exam, don't say that this we look in respiratory, this we don't look in cardiovascular system. Those words should not be utilized. So in inspection, the entire shape of the chest, including whether it is emphysematous, flat or normal, is there any local deformities in the form of a retraction, localized retraction or bilateral retraction, or you also look for any swelling, look at the intercostal space, bulging, fullness, flatness, or there is a retraction in an intercostal space. And while looking at the shape of the chest, look at the sternum, ribs and vertebra. Any deformity. This is in general in a respiratory system, but it is a part of even cardiovascular system. But in cardiovascular system specifically, we have to mention separately regarding the shape of pericardium. Now, in a normal person, if the shape of the pericardium is changed, by and large, the shape of the pericardium will be mainly in the form of bulging. It will be because of congenital heart disease, maybe cyanotic or maybe acyanotic heart disease. And occasionally, there will be a chest deformity if the child develops rickets, scurvy in early childhood. In that case, in a case of ricket, you will have a rickettic rosary, Harrison sulcus, sternal deformity in the form of what we call as a pectus excavatum or pectus carinatum. Carinatum is more common than excavatum in case of ricket. And you will have a rickettic rosary all along the costochondral junction, which will be non-tender. But in a case of a scurvy, it will be a tender swelling. And we call scorbutic rosary. And Harrison sulcus will be in the lower part of the chest, where you will have a little groove along the attachment of the diaphragm. This will be characteristic in a case of a ricket. So you look at those deformities, which are more common in children, which will not be seen in an adult. And precordial deformity in adult is absolutely rare. But if the person has got a aneurysm, you can have a swelling, which will be a pulsatile swelling, very frequently seen in a chest. And that is quite common if you get an aneurysm in arch of aorta or in ascending aorta. It is extremely difficult in a case of a descending aorta. Not possible. But in a case of ascending aorta and arch of aorta aneurysm, you can get an erosion through the sternum or through the ribs, and swelling may be there, which may be pulsatile. So any pulsatile swelling, very, very important to look for. We have already discussed regarding the position of trachea and position of apical impulse. We'll be discussing in little bit more detail. That we know very well, if the trachea is shifted, either because of push or because of pull, along with that, the mediastinum is also shifted. If there is severe pressure, either because of push or because of pull, we already mentioned push is mainly because of the pleural pathology, very rarely because of the lung pathophysiology. And in a lung pathophysiology, which pushes is absolutely rare. Occasionally, there may be a little push of trachea because of tumor, particularly apical tumor. In that case, the trachea may be shifted, but mediastinum may not shift much. And that is we call as a Penkos tumor. But in case of a pleural pathology, we usually use the word massive. So massive pleural effusion, massive hydrothorax, massive hydropneumothorax, total pneumothorax, tension pneumothorax, then hemothorax, but it has to be a massive enough. So hemothorax, empyema, chylothorax, all these conditions will have a positive pressure. And combination, hydropneumothorax, pyopneumothorax, hemopneumothorax, all those, and whenever they are massive, they can push trachea as well as mediastinum to the opposite side. So in case of a right side pathophysiology, the entire mediastinum will be shifted to left side, in which the apex will be outside the midclavicular line, and it will be good number of time misdiagnosed as cardiomegaly. So whenever a trachea is to the left side, and if it is because of pull or push, pull from the left and push from the right, do not comment on cardiomegaly. But if there is a pull from the right and there is a push from the left, and apical impulse is on the midclavicular line or just outside the midclavicular line, because the entire mediastinum, when it is shifted to right side, the apical impulse should be very close to the sternum. In place of that, if it is still in the midclavicular line, person is definitely having cardiomegaly. So this point should be kept in mind. Now, another thing which you have to keep in mind is if mediastinum is not shifted, only trachea is shifted, it is more in favor of apical lung pathophysiology, where it will be pulled to the same side because of fibrosis collapse of apical lobe. And as far as pleural pathology is concerned, pleural fibrosis and thickened pleura, that will pull the trachea to the same side. And push will be mainly because of Penkos tumor, what we call as an apical lobe tumor. So in that condition, only trachea will be shifted and there will be no shift of mediastinum. So this thing should be kept in mind. It will be very helpful to you in your oral exams as well as in your everyday practice. If you see sometime a shift of trachea and there is no shift of mediastinum, which can be also confirmed by what we call as an X-ray. But clinically, when you are looking at, even if there is no facilities of X-ray, you can pick up this particular point. Now, without any change in trachea position, if trachea is center, is in the center, and there is no shift of apical impulse, that is normal. And if the trachea is in the center and apical impulse is just outside the midclavicular line, it is cardiomegaly. In a normal person, it is inside the midclavicular line. We'll be discussing in detail regarding the position of apical impulse, in which case, what is the type of apical impulse, then pulsations. We already discussed regarding a dilated veins in respiratory system, so I'll not be repeating. Scars, some of the scar also we have discussed, pigmentation, swelling, back, that is spine, and pulsation. We have discussed all these things, so I will not be taking again a time in dilated vein, scar. We'll be showing you some of the photographs. Pigmentation, swelling, and back, spine. JVP we'll be discussing in detail separately. And we have already mentioned in a respiratory system, accessory muscle of respiration. So now we are going to discuss regarding position of trachea, relation with apical impulse. Then what you look in apical impulse, type of apical impulse, and pulsation. So first, as far as shape is concerned, we have discussed in detail in respiratory system. Go through that particular video. We have discussed regarding bony cage, different types of chest shapes, barrel, flat, localized and generalized retraction, bulging, sternal deformity, that is pectus excavatum, pectus carinatum, ribs, which may be congenitally fused, absent, fracture rib, flial chest, costochondral junction abnormalities, inner spine, scoliosis, kyphosis, kyphoscoliosis, gibbous, lordosis, regarding intercostal space, costal angle, acute, obtuse, all this we have discussed. All this we have discussed. And any congenital deformities or deformities can be because of lung or because of heart or because of aorta, all those things we have discussed in shape of the chest in respiratory system. But here I have already mentioned that is the portion of the chest wall which covers the anterior surface of the heart, we call that as a precordium. So precordial deformity will be there if a person gets big cardiomegaly before the ribs becomes completely calcified and costochondral junction becomes calcified. So in a newborn children, if the person is already having a congenital heart disease, which may be cyanotic or asyanotic heart disease, there will be precordial bulging. Precordial retraction is very common in case of a pericarditis, which will heal by pericardial fibrosis and then constrictive pericarditis. In that case, you can have a retraction. We'll be mentioning in further slide. And I already mentioned that in case of an aortic aneurysm, even in adult, after erosion of the chest wall, you can get a pulsatile swelling. And it will be very common in ascending aorta or arch of aorta aneurysms. Regarding lung and congenital deformities, we have already mentioned in respiratory system. So we have mentioned all these things. So I'm not going to take much time. Yes, in oral exam, they will ask you the second name for pectus excavatum. It is also called as a cobbler chest. And as far as pectus carinatum is concerned, it is called pigeon chest. So do remember that name, pigeon chest or Pectus carinatum, and it is also quite common in rickets. And once in a while, you can have sternal deformity following a surgery, particularly when the surgery is done by mid-split sternal scar. And we have also discussed regarding the spine deformity, which can also produce deformity of the entire chest wall, and that can mislead you. This slide I've already shown you. This is normal. This is, you can see that AP diameter is markedly increased. So this is very peculiar in case of a barrel-shaped chest. There is a smooth deformity of the spine here. We call kyphosis. Here the sternum is inward, that is excavatum. Your sternum is bulging out, carinatum. You can see this is carinatum, this is excavatum, this is again excavatum, this is carinatum. You can see a sternal scar, mid-sternal split scar. Usually this is for a surgery for mediastinal structure or major surgery on lung or open heart surgery, particularly for valve replacement, etc. Nowadays, all this majority of the procedure are replaced by minimal invasive surgery. So you look at the chest wall, you look at the shape of the chest. We already mentioned flat chest, very frequently asked in your oral, the causes. In cardiovascular system, don't forget Marfan syndrome. And in general, cachexia, cancer, tuberculosis. And classical barrel-shaped chest, emphysema. And we have already mentioned all the other finding on inspection in emphysema. They ask you very frequently in oral. I'm repeating again. AP diameter will be equal to transverse diameter in emphysematous chest. We call as a barrel-shaped chest. The epigastric angle, or we call costal angle, will be obtuse instead of acute. Intercostal space will be widened. Ribs will be horizontal. Intercostal space will be full. Sometimes it is also bulging. And respiratory movement is markedly diminished. And you might have even accessory muscle of respiration working. These are all the different findings you can come across in case of emphysema. And we have already told you that a precordial shape will change if the cardiac disease is congenital or in a very, very early childhood. And occasionally, very, very uncommon, if there is a person who has got a massive pericardial effusion, which can produce intercostal bulging rather than entire precordium being abnormal. We have mentioned that costal angle will be wide or obtuse in case of emphysema. So intercostal space will become wide in case of emphysema. Ribs will be horizontal and intercostal space will be bulging and full. And on left side, if you get intercostal space bulging, one of the another condition is massive pericardial effusion. So look for precordial bulging, suggestive of congenital heart disease, particularly cyanotic and asyanotic heart disease, or congenital valvular heart disease may be there, possible. And occasionally, we have told you that in adult, massive pericardial effusion can produce intercostal bulging rather than deformities. So bulging is very common in congenital heart disease. In early childhood, if a person gets rheumatic heart disease, is again not common. And that will not be possible to produce precordial bulging. Rare, absolutely rare. And pericardial effusion, we have mentioned in adult life. Aortic arch aneurysm can produce pulsatile swelling. By and large, flat chest, classical in case of Marfan syndrome, as far as cardiovascular system is concerned. And as far as general is concerned, malignancy, HIV, tuberculosis, severe cachexia, malnutrition, etc. And we have told you, pigeon chest, classical in case of rickett, or pectus excavatum, congenital deformities, and funnel-shaped chest, or pectus excavatum, sorry, this will be pectus carinatum. Pigeon chest will be pectus carinatum. And funnel chest is pectus excavatum or funnel chest or cobbler chest. These are the spinal deformities, scoliosis. This is multiple deformities. And partly because of hemivertebra. So very odd deformities you can come across. Then we look at the position of trachea. I already mentioned regarding push and pull. Only shift of trachea in apical pathology and shift of trachea with mediastinum shift will be in a case of a massive pleural pathophysiology rather than lung pathophysiology. And if you see the sternomastoid being prominent on one side, it is called as a trail sign or trail sign. Yes, this is one of the questions for oral. Do remember. Now, I'm going to talk regarding apical impulse. In normal person, average build individual, apical impulse will be seen in a left side, fifth intercostal space, just inside the mid-clavicular line. This you will be able to identify in a male very clearly because it will be just below the nipple in male and just inside the nipple. So that is we call it a mid-clavicular line because nipple is exactly in the mid-clavicular line and that is in a fourth intercostal space. Now in female it will be extremely difficult because presence of a breast tissue. You cannot sometimes able to make out on inspection. So you can mention apical impulse is not visible but don't say absent. So I'll be mentioning what are some of the questions which are very frequently asked in your oral. So say we take it for granted a male person. We say that the apical impulse is just inside the mid-clavicular line, normal. Apical impulse is on the mid-clavicular line or just outside the mid-clavicular line. If it is just outside the mid-clavicular line, RVH. If it is grossly downwards and outwards. Downwards means quite down below the nipple. So it is called downwards. And outwards means close to anterior axillary line. If it is downwards and outwards, gross cardiomegaly. And whenever you get a gross cardiomegaly, it is very frequently because of a left ventricle hypertrophy along with dilatation. So in a person with a huge cardiomegaly, it is quite common in a case of a dilated cardiomyopathy or because of a LV dilatation with hypertrophy, which is very peculiar in case of mitral regurgitation, aortic regurgitation. These two conditions will produce more of dilatation as compared to hypertrophy. So you will get a huge cardiomegaly. And another condition which can also produce a huge cardiomegaly is dilated cardiomyopathy, which is a congenital conditions or what we call as a pathophysiology which involves the myocardium and produces LV cavity being quite big enough. So LV cavity volume is markedly increased. That's why we call dilated cardiomyopathy. And it is involvement of the myocardium. So cardiomyopathy. So in those conditions, you can have a very huge cardiomegaly. And RVH, you will get classical in case of a corpulmonal, pulmonary stenosis, pulmonary hypertension. And good number of times, you can also have a RVH secondary to LVH. Then we call it a BVH, biventricular hypertrophy. So this is if the person is having trachea in the center, no shift of mediastinum and male person. You will be able to make out this very easily. But when you cannot identify very clearly the site of apical impulse, in case of female, emphysema, obesity, maybe male or female, emphysema also male or female, female because of presence of breast tissue. Also, if there is a massive pericardial effusion, constrictive pericarditis, if the person has got left side lung pathophysiology, like if the mediastinum is grossly shifted to the right side and now apical impulse is behind the sternum, massive push from left or pull from the right. We already mentioned the pull condition like massive collapse, massive fibrosis, as far as lung is concerned, collapse and fibrosis. And as far as pleural pathology is concerned, massive thickened pleura and massive pleural fibrosis that will pull to the side and push, because of the pleural pathology, massive effusion, all fluid, hydro, effusion, pyo, hemo, chylo, all those, if they are massive, air, tension pneumothorax, total pneumothorax, and combination, hydropneumothorax. And then don't forget a big mass in the pleural cavity, that is mesothelioma. So all this will push the mediastinum to the opposite side, and you will have an apical impulse behind the sternum, and then you will not be able to identify clearly. And don't forget, if person has got dextrocardia, then in that case the apical impulse will be on the right side, you will be looking at the left, and you will not be able to identify. So in those conditions, don't mention the word apical impulse is absent. If patient is alive, apical impulse has to be there. So always say that apical impulse is not localized. I'm not able to locate properly. I'm not visualizing the apical impulse. And what are the cause of those non-visualization of apical impulse will be asked to you in your oral. So do remember that. And apical impulse will be absent only in one condition. Absent, that is when the person is dead. So do, that is regarding location. And then if the apical impulse is very clearly visualized, then whether it is cardiomegaly or normal, I've already mentioned RVH will be just outside the midclavicular line. And in case of LVH and big dilatation, it will be downwards and outwards. So space downwards, quite below the nipple. And as far as outward is concerned, along the midclavicular line, it is quite away from the midclavicular line, towards anterior axillary line. So if it is in the anterior axillary line or a mid axillary line or posterior axillary line, it is a huge cardiomegaly. And I've given you two common conditions. Don't forget, a valvular heart disease, among the valvular heart disease, MR and AR, mitral regurgitation, aortic regurgitation, two classical conditions, or permutation combinations. Say person has got MR with AR, or person has got big AR with AS, all those permutation combination. And RVH is quite common in pulmonary hypertension, core pomona, pulmonary stenosis. So this will be some condition where you will have a pure RVH. But good number of time LVH will end up with RVH. Then we call that as a biventricular hypertrophy. So this will be regarding the position of apical impulse. Now there is another thing which sometimes they can ask you in oral. What is the type of apical impulse? By and large, it is very difficult to identify the type unless a person is little thin built and you can see clearly the apical impulse. In a normal person, usually there is no characteristic description of that apical impulse pulsation. We usually say normal. But when it is forcible, you see that apical impulse with coming with the force, then we call forceful apical impulse. That is better identified by palpation rather than on inspection. But if you see the apical impulse which is forceful and sustained for some period of time, then we call as a apical impulse is sustained. I'll be showing you that slide next. Or we call heaving apex beat. So if you can identify, then only utter the word in oral exam. If you are not able to identify clearly, you can use your palpatory findings and then mention. This is the question which is very frequently asked to you in your oral. In which condition the apical impulse will not be visualized or will be difficult to localize, difficult to identify where it is? Obesity, female, emphysema, behind the rib, behind the sternum, massive pericardial effusion, cardiac tamponade, severe congestive heart failure, dextrocardia, and left side condition which is pushing the entire mediastinum to the right side, or there is a pull from right. So always remember both these conditions. And absent in only one condition is death. This is a very, very common things which is asked in your oral. So left side conditions and right side condition will be pull. As far as lung is concerned, massive prolapse, massive fibrosis. And as far as the pleura is concerned, massive fibrosis and massive thickened pleura. But those are not so common. But push will be more common. That is massive pleural effusion and tension pneumothorax. Keep those things in mind. And very, very important things, very frequently ask in your oral. So that will be there. So look for those conditions. So right ventricular hypertrophy, what are the conditions which will produce left ventricular hypertrophy, dextrocardia, etc. So RVH, mitral stenosis, cor pulmonale, pulmonary hypertension, pulmonary stenosis, LVH, MR, AR, most common. And then you can have a dilated cardiomyopathy, another common. While in case of hypertension, it will be usually hypertrophy rather than dilatation. In MR and AR, it will be dilatation, so it will be a big dilated heart. And we have already told you that you will have an effect of massive right side pleural effusion, which will shift the mediastinum to opposite side, and pneumothorax, which will shift to the opposite side, and you will have an apparent cardiomegaly. That you should be keeping in mind. And if there is a pull to the right side, the apical impulse will be behind the sternum. And this will be because of massive prolapse on the right side and massive pulmonary fibrosis, pleural fibrosis, and thickened pleura. So, this already, okay. Then another thing, just out of way. Because of diaphragm being lifted up or pushed up, in case of obesity, pregnancy, huge ascites, a tumor which is arising from pelvis, particularly ovarian tumor, uterine pathophysiology, will push the diaphragm up. And whenever the diaphragm is pushed up, the heart position will be transverse, which will give you apparent, ideally there is no cardiomegaly, but the apical impulse will be little outside the midclavicular line. So do keep it in mind, in a person with obesity, pregnancy and ascites, if apical impulse is just outside the midclavicular line, it may be because of push of diaphragm upward. While in case of a thin build individual, a person who is having emphysema or person who is having a height which is more, taller, in that condition, the apical impulse will be little more inside the midclavicular line. So these two things should be kept in mind. By and large, we are examining in a supine posture. We have already mentioned that it will be just inside the midclavicular line on the left side. And in a male, very easy to identify, just below the nipple and just inside the midclavicular line. While in case of a dextrocardia, it will be on the right side. We already mentioned forceful will be classical in case of LVH. This is only on palpation you will be able to identify. Very difficult to identify the characteristic of apical impulse on inspection. Heaving will be because of hypertrophy plus dilatation, classical in case of a MR or AS with AR, etc. I am not going into detail. So just keep that thing in mind. And we already mentioned that it will be very difficult to identify the position in case of female, obesity, emphysema, when it is behind the rib, in case of massive pneumothorax and pleural effusion on the left side, or because of massive shift of mediastinum to the right because of the pull from the right side, etc. Now, this is another thing which is very frequently can be asked in your oral, that is normally apex will produce impulse which will be outward. So with each systole, you will have an impulse which will show you pulsation outwards. But during that particular apical impulse, if it is pulled inwards, it is classical in case of a constrictive pericarditis. There are two names given, Skoda's sign or broadband sign. These are the two things which you can remember. Maybe ask in your oral, if you answer this, you get a credit. And whenever you get a necessary muscle of respiration being prominent, it is very frequently in case of a person with congestive cardiac failure, severe CHF, or in a person with respiratory disease like acute exacerbation of COPD, status asthmaticus, severe asthma, ARDS, laryngeal obstruction, etc. So do look for accessory muscle of respiration and do look for what we call as a respiratory distress sign. In a normal person, apart from apical impulse, pulsation are not seen in pulmonary area, in aortic area, in tricuspid area, infraclavicular region, in carotid region, suprasternal notch, or on the right side of the chest, in costal angle at the xiphoid sternum, in epigastrium, and in intercostal region. Meaning, in an average build individual, you don't see pulsation other than apical impulse. Pulmonary area is on the left side, second intercostal space. Aortic area is on the right side, second intercostal space. Tricuspid area is on the left side, parasternal region, fourth and fifth intercostal space. Infraclavicular region on the right as well as left, look for pulsation. Carotid pulsation will be markedly prominent in certain conditions, we'll be discussing further. If you see the suprasternal notch pulsation, they are abnormal. If you see any pulsation on the right side of the chest, it is again abnormal. Xiphoid sternum, or what we call is a costal angle, epigastrium, intercostal space, and even in a right hypochondrium. So do look for this pulsation. I'll be mentioning here, if you see the pulsation in a pulmonary area, yes, it will be also mentioned in a palpation also. But at this stage, in an oral, if it is asked, what will be the answer? Pulsation in a pulmonary area will be prominent in case of pulmonary hypertension, dilated pulmonary artery, very rarely pulmonary artery aneurysm. Aortic area pulsation will be very prominent in AR, aortic regurgitation, dilated aortic root or aortic arch of aorta or ascending aorta aneurysm. In tricuspid area, it will be because of dilated left ventricle. In left side infraclavicular region, if you see pulsation, it is classical in case of a PDA, patent ductus arteriosus. If you see a big carotid pulsation, it is very characteristic in a hyperdynamic circulation, or we call hyperkinetic circulation. One of the classical example is aortic regurgitation, and that is given a name, carotid pulsation or dancing carotid. And secondary to that, another name is given is Corrigan pulse. And with that pulse, you can get even a nodding of the head. It is called Alfred de Musset sign, or it called as a titubation. So these are some of the things which you can identify. If you get a suprasternal notch pulsation, it is very frequently in a severe tachycardia, particularly supraventricular tachycardia. Occasionally, if there is an abnormal artery, which is called thyroidema artery, which is supplying the isthmus part of the thyroid gland arising from arch of aorta. So you can get pulsation in that region. Also, you can see the pulsation if there is an arch of aorta aneurysm. You can have a pulsation in a suprasternal notch. Odd conditions. By and large, if you see a pulsation on the right side and close to the midclavicular line, it may be because of dextrocardia. Do remember, if you see the pulsation in a fourth intercostal space, just below the nipple, on the right side, it may be because of dextrocardia. By and large, it is because of dextrocardia. If you see pulsation in the costal angle at the xiphoid sternal region, it will be because of RVH, which is very frequently in case of a cor pulmona. Second condition which can produce pulsation in a that subcostal angle, or we call as the epigastrium, it will be because of a thin built individual, because of aorta, or maybe because of abdominal aortic aneurysm, or maybe tumor sitting on the aorta, particularly lymph nodes sitting on the aorta. So that will produce pulsation in the center, we call as a midline, and very close to the epigastrium because of aorta, thin-billed individual, aortic aneurysm, we call as abdominal aortic aneurysm, or tumor sitting on the aorta, and cardiac-wise, RVH. If you see a pulsation in the intercostal, I already mentioned, it is called as a Sussman's sign. So do look for that. And it is a characteristic sign in a case of a coarctation of aorta. And if you see a pulsation along the right costal margin, it is because of liver pulsation. Absolutely difficult to identify. Also, it is difficult to identify pulsation even on palpation. So on inspection, it is absolutely difficult. But theoretical, if they ask you if liver is enlarged and if you see a pulsation along the right costal margin, if it is with pulse, it is systolic, it will be because of tricuspid regurgitation, and if it is after the pulse, it is diastolic, it will be because of tricuspid stenosis. You look at the scar, which we have mentioned in detail in case of a respiratory system. Mid-sternal scar is very commonly done for mediastinal surgery, mainly for trachea, esophagus, mediastinal mass, mediastinal lymph nodes, thymus, etc. And also open heart surgery for valvular, valve replacement, valvular surgery. All these are now replaced by a minimal invasive surgery where it is usually done with a small round hole, and that is by what we call as fiber optic instruments. We call as a non-invasive, minimal invasive procedure, actually not invasive, minimal invasive procedures, endoscopic surgery. If you see an intercostal scar, quite frequently it is because of a drainage procedure done on a pleural cavity. If it is in the upper part, it is mainly for pneumothorax. If it is in the lower part, it is mainly for what we call as hemo or hydropneumothorax, etc. You can have a burn scar, you can have a branding marks, and you can have a injury marks. And occasionally, you can have a CABG scar seen on the front part of the chest. You can see this is a mid-sternal long scar. You can see this keloid formation. And whenever you see the scar, Nutan, sorry for interruption. And in a scar, you look for the site, approximately the length. On inspection, you should not mention 4 cm or 5 cm. You can mention from where to where it is extending. Is there any keloid formation, any discharge, any gaping in the scar, any hernia or any deformities at the scar level? And you should look for a branding mark scar also, a burn scar or injury marks. These are the, you can see a small chest drainage scar. This is thoracotomy scar. This is thoraco outlet scar. This is a median sternotomy. You can see that big scar extending right from suprasternal notch up to zephysternum. And this is a thoracoplasty scar. So these are different scars. Nowadays, you will not see such scars. These scars, major scar will not be seen unless it is absolutely necessary. Then you look at the pigmentation, like spider nevi. These are spider nevi. These are telangiectasia. These are what we call as tattoo. You can have a herpes scar. Look at vitiligo. You can have a tinea corporis. You can have a black pigmentation in case of Addison's. You can have hypopigmented patches of leprosy. You can have a hypopigmented portion in vitiligo also. And you can have a post-herpetic pigmentation scar. Dilated vena, I've already mentioned, in superior vena cava or inferior vena cava obstruction. So in a superior vena cava or inferior vena cava obstruction, I've already mentioned, you will have a dilated vein, which will be vertically dilated veins. Like that. Okay. 1 minute. Hurry up. And also in case of a subclavian vein obstruction. In a case of a subclavian vein obstruction, you will have a scar which will be seen very commonly close to the shoulder joint, that is in the upper part of the chest, which will be dilated veins. While in a superior vena cava and inferior vena cava obstruction, I mentioned in detail in respiratory system. You can go through a video on a respiratory system examination. That is regarding a superior vena cava and inferior vena cava obstruction. Yes, very frequently asked in your oral. In SVC obstruction, you will have a puffiness of face, edema of upper limb. You will have a dilated veins in upper limb. You will have a dilated veins vertically down, tortuous vein seen on the chest as well as abdomen. And on inspection, don't mention the direction of the blood flow. On palpation, you can mention regarding a direction of blood flow in superior vena cava. It will be from above downwards. In inferior vena cava, it will be from below upwards. In IVC obstruction, you will have edema of lower limb, ascites, splenomegaly, hepatomegaly, and oliguria. That will be finding in case of a IVC obstruction. While in SVC obstruction, puffiness of face, edema of neck, edema in upper limb, dilated veins in upper limb, and also edema of chest wall. Those will be the additional finding. And in subclavian vein, you will have a dilated veins along the shoulder, close to the shoulder. And then you also look at the JVP, whether it is elevated, normal, and if it is elevated, it is pulsatile, non-pulsatile. We have shown you all these diagrams, all these photographs in respiratory system examination. Regarding IVC obstruction, this is, if you get a dilated veins vertically down like this, this is IVC or SVC obstruction. This is caput medusa. This will be along the epigastrium, very classical, good number of time, Bert-Chiari syndrome. This is dilated veins, big dilated veins. This has to be superior vena cava or inferior vena cava obstruction. You can see these are dilated veins over the abdomen. And if it is close to the umbilicus, these are dilated veins over the chest as well as abdomen, IVC obstruction or SVC obstruction. This will be more dilated vein close to the shoulder in superior vena cava or what we call as a subclavian vein obstruction. So if you see that, this is more common in SVC obstruction. Then regarding swelling, site, size, shape, surface, impulse on cuffing, pulsation, color, etc. This will be pulsatile swelling because of aortic aneurysm. This is gynecomastia. These are secondary metastasis. Yes, another additional thing. If you see a small swelling, either in the right shoulder, close to the right shoulder, we call right infraclavicular region, or a left infraclavicular region in a male, and if it is square or round in shape, it is because of a pacemaker. Either maybe ICD or a pacemaker. Don't try to palpate and move that particular part. The pacemaker wire may get dislodged and person may come in problem. Yes, this is pacemaker. And in female, very frequent it is put below the breast tissue so that it cannot be seen in the chest part. So to hide that, it is put And here you can see the suture wires. So some surgery has been done, and this is an implant of a pacemaker. Now this may be CRT, or it may be ICD, or it may be pacemaker, whichever. So you will have to identify. Say here you can see there are three wires. So it will be biventricular and one atrial pacing. So triple pacing. And also look for JVP. We'll be discussing separately in detail regarding JVP. We'll be having one full lecture on JVP. So I end my lecture here. This is JVP you should look for. This is external jugular vein. Sorry, this is external jugular vein. Internal jugular vein will be here. It is a little difficult to identify, but if you see the fullness between the sternocleidomastoid and trachea, here, if you see the fullness, this is a sternocleidomastoid, this is trachea, and in this gap, if you see full and you see little pulsation, and if there are two pulsation with one impulse, one pulse, then it is more likely to be venous. Single pulse, prominent pulsation is more likely to be carotid. So we'll be discussing in detail in that. So this is what you look in an inspection. Almost 50-60% of the part I would discuss already previously in a respiratory system. If I miss something in this particular chapter, you can go through a respiratory system inspection, palpation in respiratory system. Go through that. So you will understand much better. So at the end of this lecture, I thank you all for taking out time. I know that your time is valuable, and I appreciate that you have spent some of the time with me. And I feel that this will be very, very helpful to you, because in your oral exam, the most common cases are cardiovascular, respiratory and alimentary. CNS cases are very, very few. So you will be asked something, even if it is a normal person, they'll ask you, look for apical impulse, examine the cardiovascular system. So this is very, very important in your oral exam, and also very important in your everyday practice. If you feel this lecture is beneficial to you, and if you like this lecture, press button like, subscribe, and you can also share with your friends if you feel that it is helpful to him. We'll see you in next lecture.